kind of a quickening of life experiences. Having gone through the AIDS crisis, rampant homelessness, the values that were engendered by the dot-com period, or should say the dot-com catastrophe, fiction has spiraled into a kind of a new dark age. Enter the noir of William T. Boldman, of Wilchris Bear, of Craig Clevenger. It's fiction that approaches you with a vigor and intensity and graphic portrayals of violence, of viscera. In a sense, really, it's kind of like punk fiction, punk noir. Our next guest is John Shirley. I felt it important to include in the anthology someone who had been involved with the cyberpunk literary movement, and John was one of the movers and shakers of that, right up there with William Gibson and Bruce Sterling. Partly because, you know, I mean, there was Blade Runner, of course, and there's many noir elements in both the novel and the film. But moreover, because I think that many of the motifs and the patterns we find in noir are throughout cyberpunk. John is the author of fiction and nonfiction. He is a screenwriter, a singer, and a songwriter. He's the lead singer of the seminal punk band Sado Nation. He has written music for Blue Oyster Cult. He's got two new forthcoming releases, a novel called Bleak History, which is out on Simon & Schuster, and Black Glass, which is his lost cyberpunk novel from ESP Books. John is helping organize an event called Lit Punk, which is happening on Saturday, February the 28th, over at the Makeout Room in San Francisco's Mission District. I'll be joined by Johnny Strike of Crime, Black Dahlia of the Dwarves, and many others who are both punk musicians and fiction writers. So please welcome John Shirley.
Yes.
See, this is suitable for framing. Don't you think that's a beautiful poster? Then you have to. You almost see Lit Punk in the background, blotted out by streams of blood. The quake, and blotted out Lit Punk up here. The pieces being read were, you know, people are reading sections of their stories, and I've read the ends, and those are, you know, they really play out well. Definitely read the end of the great stories. I'm going to read a little bit of the beginning of this. Start at the beginning and read till it feels like it's slightly too long. This story is a kind of an urban fantasy-ish sort of thing. Set in the Mission District in San Francisco, and in the first part, it's basically a guy planning a crime. He's an amateur, and not a gifted amateur. And eventually, it, you know, becomes an entry into a sort of subterranean demi-world, and a sort of surreal experience towards the end of the story, and when it starts to get there, I'll probably quit. It's called Ash. Ash, watch the police car pull up to the entrance of the Casa of Valencia. The door to the apartment building on the edge of San Francisco's Mission District was almost camouflaged by the businesses around it, wedged between the standout orange and blue colors of the Any Kind Check Cashing Center and the San Salvador restaurant. Ash made a note on his pad, sipped his cappuccino, as a bus hulked around the corner, blocking his view to the window of the espresso shop. The cops had shown up a good 13 minutes after he called in the anonymous tip on a robbery at the Casa Valencia, which worked out good. But when it was time to pop the armored car at the check-cashing center next door, they might show up more briskly, especially if the cashier hit a silent alarm. The bus pulled away. Only a few cars passed, impatiently clogging the corner of 16th and Valencia, then dispersing. Pedestrians, with clothes flapping, hurried along in tight groups as if they were being tumbled by the moist February wind, blown instead by eagerness to get off the streets before this twilight became dark. A second cop cruiser arrived, pulling up just around the corner from the first one, which was double parked with its lights flashing. By now, though, the bruise-eyed hotel manager from New Delhi or Calcutta or wherever was telling the first cop that he hadn't called anyone. It was a false alarm, probably called in by some junkie he'd evicted just to harass him. The chunky white cop nodded in watery sympathy. The second cop, a black guy, called to the first through the window of his SFPD cruiser. They both split off to Dunkin' Donuts. Ash relaxed, checking his watch. Any minute now, the armored car would be showing up for the evening money drop-off. It was a run of check cashing after 5 o'clock. Ash sipped the dregs of his cappuccino. He thought about the .45 and the shoebox under his bed. He needed target practice, on the slim chance he had to use a gun. The thought made his heart thud and his mouth grow dry and his groin tighten. He wasn't sure if the reaction was fear or anticipation. This was being alive. Planning a robbery, executing a robbery, pushing back at the world, making a dent in it this time. For 39 years, his responses to the world's bullying and indifference had been measured and careful and more or less passive. He played the game, pretending he didn't know the dealer was stacking the cards. He'd worked faithfully, first for Grenoble Insurance, then for Serenity Insurance, a total of 17 years, and it had made no difference at all. When the recession came, Ash's middle management job was jettisoned like so much trash. Shouldn't have surprised him. First at Grenoble, then at Serenity, Ash had watched helplessly as policyholders had been summarily cut off by the insurance companies at the time of their greatest need. Every year, thousands of people with cancer, with AIDS, with accident, paraplegia, cut off from the benefits they'd spent years paying for, shoved for the numerous loopholes insurance industry lobbyists worked into the laws. That should have told him. If they do it to some 10-year-old kid with leukemia, and by God, they did it every damn day, they'd do it to Ash. Come the recession, bang, Ash was out on his ear with minimum benefits. And the minimum, flat out, was not enough. Fumbling through the casing process, Ash made a few more perfunctory notes as he waited for the armored car. His hobby horse reading was books about crime, and the books had told him that professional criminals case the place by taking copious notes about the surroundings. Next to any kind check cashing was Lizong, hairstyling for men and women, and next to that, a Starshine video owned by a Pakistani. On the Valencia side was the Casa Valencia entrance. The hotel rooms were layered above the Salvadoran restaurant, a dry cleaner's, a leftist bookstore. Across the street, opposite the espresso place, was Casa Lucas Productos, a Hispanic supermarket selling fruit and cactus pears and red bananas and plantains and beans by the 50-pound bag. It was a hearty leftover from the days when this was an entirely Hispanic neighborhood. Now it was as much Korean and Arab and Hindu and white. 2 doors down from the check-cashing scam, in front of a liquor store, a black guy in a dirty hooded sweatshirt stationed himself in front of passing pedestrians, blocking them like a linebacker to make it harder to avoid his outstretched hand. That could be me soon, Ash thought. I'm doing the right thing. One good hit to pay for a business franchise of some kind somewhere. Something that'd do well in a recession. Maybe a movie theater people needed to escape. Maybe his own check-cashing business with better security. Ash glanced to the left, down the street, toward the entrance to the BART station, San Francisco subway. But this entrance, only one short block from the check-cashing center. At 5:18, give or take a minute, a northbound subway would hit the platform, pause for a moment, then zip off down the tunnel. Ash would be on it with the money, escaping more efficiently than he could ever hope to, driving a car in city traffic, and more anonymously. The only problem would be getting to the subway station handily. He was 5'6" and pudgy, his legs a bit short, his wind even shorter. He was going to have to sprint that block and hope nobody played hero. If he knew San Francisco, though, nobody would. He looked back at the check-cashing center just in time to see the Armored Transport of California truck pull up. Checked his watch. As of the last week, just about 5:12, there was a picture insignia of a knight's helmet on the side of the truck. The rest of the truck painted half black and half white, which was supposed to suggest police colors, scare thieves. Ash wouldn't be intimidated by a paint job.